Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your absolutely most favorite brother from another mother, and I'm wearing...
I always tell Brother Patrick, he tells me, people are always trying to come up with dates for the rapture. Folks, be ready for the rapture any day. Don't worry about what day, just be ready any day.
Amen.
That'll solve your whole problem on the rapture.
That's right. Stop trying to calculate the days. That's right.
Yeah, it's simple. Just be ready any day. Any day. And if you're ready every day, it won't matter what day it is.
Right. Amen. That's a good point. Great point, Brother Sid. That's what it is. I got people that try to calculate the rapture date all the time with all kinds of, from movies and TV shows and their shoe size. And, you know, and as I always mention, they use the circumference of the earth. What are they going to do if they find out the earth is flat when they get to heaven? Those calculations they did were a waste of time.
Yeah, when they break out of here, they've been heading up to heaven and they look back and they see this thing's just a flat disc hung in the sky. As God said, he hung it immovable, as you quoted early in this video, and they go, whoop, you know.
So, oops.
At least you know you were lied to. That's the thing you'll gain from there. So maybe you can uncover some of that now.
That's right. Yeah, it's always nice to know the truth, you know. I don't like to be played for a fool. And, you know, I don't like someone tricking on me. And even though, you know, like Halloween, I don't want nobody doing no trick-or-treating on me. And I want to know the truth as much as I can, you know. And, you know, as Brother Sid and I was talking earlier, we keep going on and on. Well, who knows who might watch it. They can cut it on and off and come back later. But, you know, like we talked about, the CIA is the one who invented the term conspiracy theories or conspiracy theorist. They come up with all these buzzwords, keywords to program people, brothers and sisters. They invented the term pro-choice instead of saying infanticidal maniacs is what
I choose to kill my own flesh and blood. Instead of using that, they use pro-choice.
That's right. Call it pro-choice. You know, that's why the Bible says in the last days, you know, it says that, what does it say? Now, I used to quote that verse all the time there in Romans. It talks about women have an unnatural affection. Women would have unnatural affection. And a lot of times people think about homosexuality, but another is of course, it's unnatural to kill your own flesh and blood. Now, that's definitely an unnatural affection. So we see that also. And it to be...
Well, and what it does is, you know, what our government has done, you know, not in the Middle East, not around the world so much, but here, they've broken down the fabric of the family to make sure that, you know, to promote, you know, infidelity on everybody's part, so women can easily get an abortion if they go out and have, you know, unprotected sex with whomever, whenever.
Right.
And so that's just part of their agenda, folks. I mean, it's the agenda. I mean,
right.
Look around. The world isn't, the Bible isn't that way. The rest of the world isn't this way. Your government's made you this way. They've programmed you this way. So,
right. Sacrificing babies to Moloch. And getting people to commit all kinds of abominations and fornications and all that. Hey, that's a win-win situation for the devil, isn't it? Abortions as birth control and as a child sacrifice and to get women to have uncontrolled sex life because there's no consequences. That is a win-win for the devil, for sure. But a loss for those who have been sucked into believing these lies from the devil. So that's the whole thing, brothers and sisters. You know, we believe the truth about the gospel and all that, but yet, and in other words, this is what I'm saying. Let me try to, you know how I always try to bring everything down to a one big sentence, you know. It's like this. In the spiritual matter, a lot of people try to separate their Christianity from their natural life. You know, they don't have a unified theory in their life. They don't have a unification of the Lord Jesus in their whole lives. So they're spiritually prepared for heaven by being saved, but they're not sanctified. And their mind is not sanctified. The way they think and live and breathe and move is not sanctified. So that's what we're talking about. These topics we're talking about is, you know, complete truth. In other words, the full truth, the full gospel, not just about salvation, but how the gospel and God's creation plays out into everyday life and even into the creation is what we're talking about in this video. So, you know, there is a unified theory. The Bible is truth, God is truth, and every man is a liar. The Bible says God is true, and let God be true, and every man a liar. You know, God is not a man that he should lie, the Bible says. And so when we look at those things, we need to not say, okay, I'm a Christian, but I believe in evolution. Even though the Bible says, if you read the Bible, there is no evolution. So, you know, you can't have, you know, you're living a contradiction. So you've got to go through every part of every way of thinking you've got. As the Bible says, bring every thought and every vain imagination into captivity to the Word of God, the Bible says. So, you know, we need to have our total mind, every category and every part of our lives lined up with the Word of God is what we're saying. In other words, you say you're a Christian, but you think abortions are okay. Or you say you're a Christian, but gay marriage is okay. You know, any kind of topic. I say I'm a Christian, but I believe in evolution. And I believe that the world evolved and all these things. So those things, they can't be like that. You can't say, okay, I take this part of the Bible and the other parts I just throw out. I take the, you know, I can get saved and go to heaven, but the rest of it, well, you know, I just don't know. Call God a liar, you know.
Something I'll bring up, and you know me pretty well, and you know my testimony. Maybe one day I get on here and tell my testimony, because it's pretty powerful if you know everything about me. And it's amazing what people will do to justify themselves when they're in the world and they're, you know, of the world. When they think they're tricking God, when they think you're fooling God, you're the fool. That's the way I'll put it.
Right.
You're the fool when you think you're fooling God.
Right.
Because I'm telling you, the Bible points it out, you know, that no drunkards,
fearful, effeminate. Fearful, drunkard, liar, all these adulterer, yeah.
None of those people inherit the kingdom of God. And
right.
That's just period. There's no, it's not, well, you know, I'm only doing it because, you know, this is my, well, I got a reason. I'm the same today, yesterday, and forever, he says.
Amen, amen, amen. Amen, Brother Sid. Well, I guess we probably went long enough tonight, but I know there are people who really love to hear, you know, like a radio show, and I know that that's, you know, a whole different way than just straight away preaching, and people enjoy it, and I do too. I love listening. Like, Coast to Coast, a lot of times they have crazy stuff on there, and I don't have time, but if I do, sometimes they have, you know, Dr. Tom Horn, who's a Christian, a former preacher who did all this stuff on the Nephilim and all that. He'll be on Coast to Coast or some of those shows, and I can listen to him talk all day when he's talking on these kind of topics. And so I know people appreciate it, and I know that I thank the Lord that God has given us the brain power and the time we've researched all these things, Brother Sid. I'm sure the Lord will be happy that if we're going to share what we know and put it out there into the blogosphere or whatever you call it, the ethernet, the internet. And get these things out there for brothers and sisters. Get people thinking, you know.
That's what I say. Think about it. I mean, just, you know, it's interesting to just think about these things, you know. Don't live in that box. People just, you know, and people say think outside the box. And I don't like that saying at all. I mean, that doesn't
right
really, you know. I'm saying if you're confined, if you put yourself in a box, you know, you should step out. You should just look around.
Right.
And see what's there. There are lots of interesting things out. Everything that you see may not be true.
Well, yeah, there's an ancient philosophy stuff there from Plato. You know, they call it Plato's cave, where it says the people are living inside a cave, and then they can just see the lights coming through the entrance of the cave and casting shadows on the wall, and that's all they can see, and they think that that's all there is, you know, till they could get free and get outside the cave and find out that they've been looking at shadows the whole time. They haven't been looking at the full picture, you know, and that's what it is. We've been lied to, especially in these last days. We've been programmed and lied to and enslaved, mentally enslaved, and physically enslaved too, you know, to the taxes and the you know, the military-industrial complex here in the U.S. and, you know, to the government's bidding. And like now, it's just a whole other thing. Like in these third world countries, the United States and the Western countries are going there with the Kyoto Treaty and the greenhouse treaty telling all these people in Africa and all that places, oh, y'all don't need cars, you don't need air conditions, you don't need TVs, you know, and trying to brainwash those people that, oh, you know, you just need to live in a undeveloped world. In other words, treating them
it's good for you.
Yeah, it's good for you. They're propagandizing the people in third world countries right now that they don't need to develop in the name of worshiping Mother Earth. And just, you know, and just manipulating those people, just like here. Like they said, they're actually, you know, I hate to quote from TV or anything. Someone had a clip on there, you know, Archie Bunker tells the truth about the New World Order or something. And it was from the old All in the Family TV show. And Archie Bunker, and it was when they had the energy crisis, you know, when they had the oil shortage and all that in 74 maybe. And Archie Bunker said, well, my whole life, the media, you know, the television and the radio has been telling me buy, 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 consume. And now they're telling me, you know, save, save, save. You know, so, you know, the Americans have been a consumer society. Because the propaganda, you know, the madmen, the Madison Avenue people, and there's a guy, I forgot his name, who's the, you know, the founding father of modern day brainwashing from Madison Avenue, who got, he's the one that came up with the idea to get women to smoke in the 1920s, 1910.
The same one that came up with to get them to put them in the workforce so they could tax them.
Was it Bernays or something like that is his name is. Bernays, I think that's him. And you're talking about maybe his son-in-law also did a lot of stuff too. But the guy that first wrote about it, his name was Bernays. I think his son-in-law is the one that did the women's movement you're talking about maybe. The women to work in the 50s and 60s. But this other, his father-in-law, this Bernays, he's the one that got women to smoke all the way back in the 20s and teens. Yeah, they brainwash people and manipulate us today. You see the commercial and have a Coke and a smile or whatever it is. And they're planting subliminal ideas in our head of any kind of topic you're talking about, like all the TV shows. You know, in the 1950s, they had Father Knows Best. And then now, in the last 20 or 30 years, every TV show shows the dad as a moron, an idiot. The mom's in charge.
Every
the children's in charge.
TV shows the guy as an idiot.
The men are dumb and don't know what they're doing, and they're childlike. And the women are in charge, and the children are in charge. All these things to break down our society, our Judeo-Christian culture and society at every level. At every level.
Yeah, we're not women haters for sure. I know I'm not.
Oh, I'm not either. Of course not.
But the point is that it's just conditioning, and you know, if the Bible's right, then the Bible's right about everything, and the man's still the head of the household. You know,
right.
If you go overseas and you wonder why the Muslims are rising up, you know, their structure's still in place there. They're not programmed, so we got them on our streets now. And so it's a whole thing that they've conditioned women in this country to believe and to make men irrelevant. And, you know,
yeah.
That's just not the Bible's way. It's not
just two babies
Bible's
and all
designed.
That stuff.
It's not
right.
God's plan. And so... We still have to, you know, we're still under God's authority.
You know, Sid, you mentioned something about how you didn't hate women. Did you, isn't it true now that you're single, aren't you? I just wanted to mention that.
That's what I said. I said I got plenty of time. I can correspond. I'm a single man, just me and my puppy dog. That's
okay.
That's kind of the way I'm rolled. That's the way I roll. And you know, that comes from that, and that comes, being single comes from that time that I should tell my testimony why I might be single. But I've been single since, I guess, 99 or 2000. I've been single a good long time.
15, 16 years, yeah.
And, yeah, I just moved back from the beach back to the metropolis near the Charlotte area. Just come back up here to be near family.
Yeah.
But still single. Still single.
Yeah. Well, you never know how it works out in this world. You know, the Lord has plans for all of us, what He wants us to do and not do, and how things come together, you just never know in our lives, you know. But, I think we need to do a video one time. You can tell your testimony, and we could talk about that, our testimonies of coming to the Lord and waking up to the New World Order and the gospel and the Lord's plan for us in this world. And I share all that next video.
I think the road, especially, you know, you were not always a perfect Christian, and I wasn't a perfect Christian, but even though we were both, you know, brought up Christian from a young age, you know, doesn't mean we didn't rebel. And I'm sure a lot of people are in that boat, you know.
Right.
Mine was probably a little more severe than yours for sure, but...
Right.
But
still, yeah.
But getting there and as you say, becoming awake now to the man, so to speak, the New World Order, it's an interesting road.
It is. It definitely is. Well, Brother Sid, I guess we better wrap it up, and we already went an hour and a half. Well, we could keep going, but we'll do another one. Let's try, maybe by the grace of God. I've been looking at, you know, keep going with it. Sister Linda wants to do one. Of course, the thing, you know, with Sister Linda Kirby, she likes to break down about the news and stuff and talk about that. And then with me and you, brother, where, you know, we're going out here on the deep end with it. So, but we need all those ways.
Subscribe to Linda Kirby's newsletter if you hadn't, you know.
Yeah.
You give her email, she'll send you that newsletter. She gets a lot of information, puts it out, you know, all the time. And for a lot of you, it's some great info, some good learning experience.
That's right. Yeah, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get every level for new believers, for people that are on the deep stuff, people that are just finding out. You know, we're trying to bring the information at every level, for beginners to the people that's done deep research. Bring it together.
And kind of like what we talked about earlier in this video, you know, all of us, all of us coming together to bring the truth. You know, she, you know, certainly has some great information. Everybody that can bring information to the table is wonderful, and we should support them all.
Right, that's right. We need
it. As long as it's in a Christian manner, you know, we don't want to, you know, going off the deep end is one thing. We don't go too far off.
Yeah, we don't want to go.
We don't want to go past Genesis or maps.
You keep know, it between Genesis and
maps.
That's
as
right.
As long as we stay in that sector right there, I think we'll be okay.
That's right. Keep it between Genesis and maps. That's right. Keep it right in there. We'll be all right. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I thank you. If anybody's watched this to the end, thank you very much. We appreciate
Amen.
It.
Amen.
And it's a marathon here. But you know, like I say, some people listen to Rush Limbaugh that's 3 hours long, or whatever you listen to. Coast to Coast is 2 or 3 hours long. So, you know,
this is good entertainment. Cut it off and do it in 30-minute segments, three 30-minute segments. You'll have it done.
Okay, I'll do that. There you go. I'll split it up. We're on three 30-minute segments, and then the first one was really going at it. Then we kind of changed up topics, and we started talking more about generally. And about the New World Order and all that. But the first part, we were talking about the flat earth. Yeah, we didn't really cover...
We rolled around, but we could narrow it down. You know, if you guys, you know, point it out to us, we'll narrow some points down for you.
Yeah, we can go back and really get into it and dig into all these things about the, you know, how the science of the spherical blue marble in space doesn't add up with observation. You know, science is the observation of nature.
There, you said it the best, you know, that you can say it. Observation and science clash on the flat earth and the ball earth.
That's right. And we got to look at things and what we can see in the real world. And what is that canal over there in England? That's something, the canals experiment where they where they can see, you know. In other words,
it was six miles. And you know, and I should have had it in front of me Every couple miles you drop, you know, you drop 2 feet, I believe it is, or
right.
Every 3 miles. I believe it's every 3 miles you drop 2 feet. Don't quote me. I'm not sure. I'll look it up. I'll be sure next time.
Right.
And so if you get 6 miles out and the little flagpole is only 6 foot tall, it drops 8 feet at that distance or ever how the math works out, and you shouldn't be able to see it, but yet they could see it perfectly. And you can see... You know, they call it mirages. You can see across Lake Michigan,
right.
Sometimes all the way to Chicago from Michigan.
Right.
You know, you can see the Chicago skyline.
50 miles in it. Yeah, 50 miles or something, yeah.
Something over 50 miles, and they call it a mirage. And it's, you know, it's just a clear day, folks.
That's right. And people who don't understand what we're saying, if the Earth was round, there's a curvature to it, and there's a formula you could calculate. I forgot what it is. Also,
I'm going to get that formula. I'll have that formula.
So, in other words, if I was looking out over the ocean, or like we said, from Michigan across to Chicago, it's more than 50 miles statute miles or nautical miles, whatever. And most of you in the world, you know, using kilometers. But anyway, there's a the Earth drops because of the, if it was curved, every so many kilometers it drops a meter, and we forgot what it is. Or every mile it drops so many feet.
My best guess is I believe it's 2 feet every 3 miles.
Or something like that. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. So
you know, it's in that ballpark.
So the example of looking across Lake Michigan to Chicago, it's supposed to be that you wouldn't even see the top of the skyscrapers. But
you couldn't even see the top of the most of the buildings.
Right. But when you look, you can see it street level, like it was just straight across. So you can see even the ground, you know, the sidewalk, much less the buildings. So in that distance of 50 miles, the curvature should be such a drop that you would just see straight horizon. You wouldn't even know there was a city there if it was round like they say.
And if your plane took off and it held at a constant level going across, you know, if it was flying, say, from let's just say, Toronto to Panama City, and you were just going straight out, you know, that by the time you got there, if you held that constant distance, if you were not constantly bringing the plane down, you'd wind up somewhere like 167,000 feet, you know, high, just flying straight. So, come on, folks, observation versus science.
I think as an example, I found something here. It's 6.5 miles is 28 feet. So whatever that is per mile, 6.5 divided by 28, that's how many feet it is per mile, whatever, because I was just looking at something here. But, yes, you know, we're on our third or fourth half hour here. We could talk about that now, which we're getting into, what you just said about the curvature. As an example, people say that the Earth is spinning. Now listen to this, brothers and sisters. The Earth is spinning at a little more than 1,000 miles an hour. Because
at the equator.
Right, at the equator. Because as the Earth is turning, it takes 24 hours for the Earth to come back where it was. So that's...
Science.
Right. So that's what they're claiming. So what Brother Sid and I are, and another thing, I don't know if you just mentioned it or not, because I was looking at that chart, gravity. You know, they say that the spin
science,
of the Earth.
Science.
Thank you, Brother Sid. Yeah, you're subliminally. Subliminally, yeah. Well, you know, they claim you should make a rap out of that, you know.
Science.
Well, you know, they say that if you're on the equator and you're spinning at a little over 1,000 miles an hour, that's what's creating the gravity to hold you on the Earth. But how come when you're on the North Pole or South Pole, you know, you're spinning at really 0 miles an hour, right?
Yeah, you're barely spinning.
Right. But the gravity's the same.
Mile an hour at the North Pole.
Right. Or how about this? If I was in Chicago, the North, or, you know, in America, North American continent, and I decided I wanted to fly to Panama City, due south, let's just say you drew a straight line. I think Chicago and Panama City are pretty much straight line. Maybe Detroit, whatever. And I took off flying due south or due north from Panama back to Chicago. And the Earth is rotating 1,000 miles an hour at the equator. And over Chicago, it's probably spinning at 500 miles an hour. How come there's no calculation of that distance? And how come when I break free from the Earth, how come I'm not going to have some kind of a slowdown? In other words, why isn't the Earth going to pass me by while I'm in the air? You know, they say, oh, you're in the atmosphere. The atmosphere is also spinning.
Well, they're going to throw, every scientist is going to throw the Coriolis effect on you.
Right.
That's the air pressure and how it moves around the Earth. And let me tell you what that is, folks. Science.
Right. The Coriolis effect is a bunch of mess.
Spinning at so many miles an hour. And you know, I say just get in a helicopter, go up, you know, hover and wait for China to come around.
Right.
You ain't got to fly. You just wait for it.
Yeah.
Coming at you at 1,000 miles an hour. Come on, folks, it's coming at you at 1,000 miles an hour. In a couple hours, it'll be here.
So, yeah, so if the Earth was spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, you could never fly east. I think you would have to fly west all the time because...
Yeah, you can't go the way... I mean, if it's spinning away from you and your plane's going, let's say typical planes fly at 525 miles an hour, roughly, that's the typical speed of a commercial aircraft. And if the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, and you're going away from the spin, if you're, you know, if it's spinning, and, you know, if it's, you know, if you're flying, like you say, to the east, And you can't ever get to where you're going because you're only going 525 and it's passing you by in a thousand.
Right.
You can't get there. You just can't get there.
You can't get
there. That's that observation versus science. You just can't get there.
You'd have to,
because the air spins. Well, it doesn't work. Why is it if the air spins and the Coriolis effect is that way? Why is the time from New York to Los Angeles and Los Angeles, New York, roughly exactly the same amount of time? You know, one way it should be pushing you so fast that you should get there in half the time if you do the math.
Right. It does.
If the Coriolis effect, you know, comes, if that's the way, it, you know, if that's your science, then you have to use it in every instance. You know, you can't just use it when it's convenient.
Right. That's the
thing about science. Sometimes it's just when it's convenient.
Right, and they built bridges over there in China. I believe they got a bridge that's 30 miles long or something. And there's no calculation for the curvature of the Earth.
No calculation, right. They took in no calculation for the curvature of the Earth when they built it.
Yeah, so how could, if I built one 30 miles long, that's going to be, I don't know how many feet it is. It's 100 feet or something maybe for 30 miles or whatever it is.
That's 4.3 on your calculation at 28, 4.3.
Per mile, so it's pretty big, and so there, and the engineers who do it, they don't have any kind of calculations for the curvature of the Earth. That just seems.
If you'll call any surveyor, you know, any licensed surveyor anywhere, and ask them how they calculate for the curvature of the Earth, they'll just act dumbfounded. They don't.
Right, it's not in there. So, you know, that's the thing about it. Because when I told as a matter of fact, it's flat. When I told people, my relatives that I told yesterday that the Earth was flat, they would say,
"Are you serious?"
Yeah, and then they said, "If the Earth was flat, we would go flying off because of
No, you're heavier than air. You'll just stand where you are.
I know.
And if you go downhill, you'll just go downhill."
They started talking about gravity, and I said, "Wait a minute.
You're at your lowest point."
Right. Who said that? You know, that all these calculations are based off of these theories. You know, I mean,
an apple falls out of the tree and we got gravity.
Yeah. They
you know why it fell? Because it's heavier than the air. It came loose.
Yeah. What do they call that? If something's heavier, there's a whole different word for what you call it.
Yeah, it's mass versus, you know,
yeah,
resistance and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I named
my dog Newton after Isaac Newton, but that was because of his Newton's, you know, riddle. It wasn't because.
Apple hitting him in the head.
It wasn't because of the gravity. It was because of his riddle, which was interesting stuff there when September came up. You know, there's some other theories. That's another theory we can talk about. What's the new date of the end of the world since it didn't happen September 23rd?
Yeah, that's true. We need to.
Need a new date. A new date for the end.
We need a new rapture date.
Oh, that's right. There's a comet or something coming by tomorrow.
Is that what it is?
Yes,
there's always something.
Listen to this video fast because it may be gone tomorrow.
Well, I know. We need to. Well, as a matter of fact, we could do a whole thing of. We could do some serious calculating and ciphering. We could do some ciphering.
I'll do the Gazensis.
I know. I wish we could get. Didn't Max Baer Jr. die?
Jethro,
didn't he die just recently? I think he did.
I'm not sure
if he didn't. I'm sorry, but I don't know. Yeah, I wish Jethro was here to help us out with some calculation ciphering for us, so we could really get to the heart of the
rest.
Yeah, yeah, that's what happened. So as a matter of fact, we should have. Jethro on here sometime because, you know, he's also an insider. You know, he was a double nut spy also. And so he probably has some Illuminati insider information from the government. As a matter of fact, he's probably in on the conspiracy about all this anyway. You know, he would probably not tell us the truth if we had him on here.
I'm not sure that he would or not. I don't see that he's passed.
Ellie May's the one who just died.
She just passed. Ellie May's the one who just passed.
Right.
You know, she made a career of that. You know, she never got out of character. She went around the country, you know, performing at fairs and stuff. She took that character, and made it her whole life. So, you know, she wasn't bitter, I guess, about the show. She made money off of it to the end.
Right. Well, that's good. I mean, you know, she made a living out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Jethro was born, you know, looks like Jethro was born like back in I'm not sure.
I don't know.
Born 1937, so he's a little old. He's a little old now.
Yeah.
He was born in December of 1937.
A lot of people doesn't know it, that his dad was a famous boxer, right? Max Baer Sr.
Right, he was. Yes, he certainly was. And Donna Douglas died in January of this year.
Right, I knew it was recent. Well, you know what? What's the date? We need to do a I think we can do a calculation of the rapture.
Well, wait a minute. You got to put the circumference of the Earth. Wait. If the Earth is flat, let's see. I'm going to do, what I'll do is I'll square that, and then I'll say 3 goes into 6 twice. And then if you take the comet on the 31st, that's another 3 and a 1. So that's 3, 4, 5, 6. So on the 6th, beware. What is it? The 5th of November?
Is it? I thought it was the Ides of March.
Well, it could have been.
Throw that in there, too. Throw that in there, too. The Ides of March, and I think there is. You could use that one, too.
What about the Ides of March? I'll have to get a couple pencils.
Remember the 5th of November. Is that the Red Brigade? Is that their thing from the Red Brigade? Is that the 5th of November thing? Or am I off? Are you talking about something else?
I don't know. There was something. Somebody was. They're crying it on YouTube.
I'm sorry. I didn't see that one. I couldn't keep up with it. Well, I think we have to come up. We need to do some serious ciphering and come up with a good date. And for the rapture.
Yeah, I'm not. You know, I got to take some. I'd have to take some look at looks at some different things.
Yeah, we'd have to
figure out some things and. Sure, you know, I have a hard time with that. Sometimes I just forget to calculate what day the rapture is.
I know. Sometimes I forget to do it also. But, I was on that
and
one.
I'm not making fun of you if you're trying to calculate when the rapture is. God bless you.
Yeah, it's true. It is true. We're not making fun. Well, we're poking fun at the fact that people are using information that's not biblical.
The day or the hour.
Yeah, they're using information that's not biblical, you know. Like there's a guy who did a great presentation about Daniel's timeline, and people have shown it all over the internet. He's got like a 4-hour slideshow and everything, and it's done in a church. It's a video of him doing it in a church, and it is an excellent theory, but the only problem is, according to his calculations, it's all supposed to have already been happening and about over with now, and people are still passing around the video.
And yeah, I hear a lot of things on
it's already passed.
On YouTube that I think this comet coming is like the third trumpet or something. We're already deep in Revelation with most people. I think we're up to getting close. I think maybe they're thinking this Revelation 9, you know, which is 9-12 or whenever the devil gets cast out, 9-12.
Yeah, they got all kinds.
They're looking for him to come on down and, you know, people don't understand that the devil's not in chains. He's, you know, he's there accusing the brethren every day.
That's right. He hasn't been
cast out. He's in heaven, folks. He's still there. Nothing happened, you know, until he gets thrown down in Revelation, you know. He's still up there, you know, telling on you everything you do wrong every minute.
That's right.
He's accuser of the brethren.
That's right. That's what he does. Like in Job, he's accuser of the brethren. And he's, you know, those powers and principalities and forces of darkness in the second heaven, they're still there. You know,
Pastor Carl, he said, look it up.
Yeah, look it up. Go look it up.
You can prove that for yourself. He is not bound in hell. He's free and in heaven. He's talking bad about you. He's talking bad about me.
Slanderer.
He knows talking bad about me.
Yeah, he probably is. Matter of fact, yeah, there's probably people who will come on here trolling who the devil's been talking to them about you. They're listening to him too, you know. That's so funny. I got a relative who's dead now, and she would call people up and say, I think she should have been on YouTube, but it was after her time. But she called up and said, hey, the devil told me you was talking about me. Mm. And what I said was, well, the devil's a liar. So if the devil told you that, then it must mean I'm not talking about
you. Well, I don't want to be in the camp with the devil.
Yeah, why is it you listening to the devil?
I always tell people, if everything's going wonderful, look around because you're not, you know, I'm not sure you're in the right camp. You might have strayed off path.
Yeah, that's right. If everything's going great, yeah, you're
exactly
right. Because the Lord said that in this life we would have tribulation. Not the tribulation,
not
but
the great tribulation. I know people just shoot.
People take anything.
There's another one. There's something. There's no need to even get into that. That's just That's a horror story when you start.
We could call this third section. Yeah, we should call this third section, or fourth section maybe. You know, insanity on we're kind of rolling on the topic of craziness on YouTube, or insanity, insane theories of YouTube theology.
YouTube, you know they like got girls gone wild. We can have YouTube gone wild.
Yeah. YouTube gone wild. Yeah, there you go.
If you can't find it on YouTube, you can't find it anywhere. I looked up one time how to replace an oven coil. You know, I looked up about training my dog, you know, and then I look at people that are supposed to be Christian, and they're telling me that I'm wrong because I'm divorced. They're telling me I'm wrong because, you know, I just get there. There's a million high theologians on YouTube telling a bunch of lies, folks.
Yeah, they'll tell you you're going to hell if you've been
divorced. Read your Bible. Learn it. That's how there's power. Power in the Word, folks. Remember that song? There's power in the Word.
Well, Jesus is the Word.
Right. Get in some of that Word and learn it, and then you can't be deceived. People can't take your lunch from you if you know the whole story.
That's right. If you're packing a weapon, you know, the Bible is the sword of the Spirit, so they can't take your lunch if you're packing a weapon. You know.
Jesus said, you know, folks, when you talk about weapons these days, it's a touchy subject. He said, if you don't have a sword, sell your clothes and go get one.
That's right. That's what he said.
So don't give up your don't listen to the government. Don't give it up. Don't. You know, there's another one we can talk about. You know, that's another programming.
Yeah,
you know,
that's another one. The Europeans now are begging for guns.
You know, biblically speaking,
right?
You know, Jesus said, you know, if you don't have a sword, sell your stuff and get you one.
Over there in Sweden and all that, the rape capital of the world now, because of those tree huggers have imported all these radical jihadists, and now the people of Sweden and all that, they got all these gun laws. Like, you know, they're begging to get a hold of guns.
I saw a headline that said, Europe now wishing for a Second Amendment.
I'm sure they are. But see, this is all by design, brothers and sisters. You want to talk truth. Because on the back of the American dollar bill, it says in Latin, it says, you know, announcing a new order for the ages or a new world order. But the first half of that sentence, and this was spoken really by Apollo through an oracle. It's called the Cumae Sibyl. It's an oracle of Apollo. A woman is possessed by the spirit of Apollo, the Antichrist, 2,000 years ago. And she said this whole prophecy. You can go look it up about the coming kingdom of Lucifer, of Apollo. And she said, by him, she's saying that out of chaos is born a new world order. So that's the first half of that sentence that's on the back of the American dollar bill. So what we're seeing now is the chaos, you know. So take away the guns, take away people's desire to have children, let them stop having kids, take away the Bible, take away Christianity. I'm talking about Europe right now first. Then flood the country with radical jihadists who want to kill you, rape you, and destroy you if you don't bow down to Allah, who says that God has no son, which is the spirit of Antichrist. You got a formula for chaos, and it's coming to America.
Right, and they've weakened the Christian religion so much in Europe that how many Christians there that even profess to be Christians will stand up to the, you know, if the guy's got the sword and he goes, I'm going to cut your head off. Here's the better one, you know, if you do have children, if you've ever been a parent or whatever, and they got your little kid and they're holding a knife to their throat and they say, well, we're going to cut your throat of your child unless you denounce your Christianity. You know?
Right.
How many people are going to throw down their sword then and denounce, you know, and denounce the Lord, you know? Yeah,
right,
there's going to be tribulation in this lifetime. There has been, you know, they tortured all the apostles and killed them. I mean,
right.
If it was good enough for them, it's got to be good enough for you.
Amen. You're right about that. Absolutely true.
But that's another subject for another day.
Right. I got to figure out how to chop up this video now. That's what I got to do.
Yeah, you might have to take two one-hour segments.
Yeah, we're getting closer to like that. Yeah, we're getting
close to two. They'll have to absorb some of this. But, yeah, we're just wandering around now. So, yeah, we'll do another one.
Yeah, we'll do another one. Yeah, we have to give us a title. So, YouTube YouTube gone wild, but what is the first one is going to be what? What are we going to call it? Flat Earth?
Flat Earth, are you serious?
Flat Earth, are you serious? Yes. Yeah. Yes, we're serious.
I believe that's the title. Are you serious? Yeah, I'm serious. I'm almost convinced. Not complete, but I'm
You're looking at information.
I'm looking at throwing the ball Earth model out just by observation.
You about ready to trade in your ball for a Frisbee? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, or a lens. It could be a little bulged in the middle, but I believe sit on pillars, just like the Bible says,
Right.
And it's not, I didn't get all this because I'm a Christian. I got this from researching information in all venues, science, Christianity, all spectrums. Don't believe everything. Don't believe anything unless you test it out.
Right.
You got to test it against the word. It's your biggest thing.
Right.
And look at it. Then look at science, look at observation, and just use basic. Here's your word of the day, folks. Logic.
Yeah.
Logic.
Yeah. Common sense.
Logically makes sense to me. The airplane trying to fly against the spin of the earth, and our airplane flying with the spin of the earth gets there so much quicker. But really, they take exactly the same time. Simple logical things.
Right.
That make you go. Things that make you go.
Yeah. Yeah, and the water staying in place, as you mentioned before at the beginning of the first video, about the earth spinning around, how is it the water doesn't go to the bottom, or how does it doesn't fly off, or how come it doesn't get, we got waves, supposedly.
70% of the earth is water, and you're telling me that all that can just kind of stay right in where it's placed, in every lake, and in every ocean, and every stream, and every river, and all the spinning, and all the gravity, and all the different aspects and computations that it would take for every one of those to be exactly the same, depending on where they're spinning, where they're flowing. It all just magically works.
Right, water flowing east sometimes, flowing west, north, and south. And then look at if there's this bulge in the ocean and all that from, they claim the earth is bulged out at the center. How come we have waves and stuff? The waves aren't affected by that. You know what I'm saying? You still got these waves, but yet there's this incredible pressure that's bulging it and all this. It just doesn't make
sense.
Science. Yeah. Mad scientists. I think that's one of those 1.21 gigawatt moments, I think it's I think we need to have a Doc Brown moment here, we got to have a Back to the Future moment here,
Speaking of your guy, Doc Marquis, I saw he even did a video on the flat earth.
Did he?
He did a radio show with Rob Skiva.
Well,
on
he's
the flat earth.
If Doc Marquis's catching up with it, then
I can't say he's on board completely. I listened to part of it, and
yeah.
I didn't listen to all of it, but I just saw it again a minute ago when I was passing through some videos. He's talking about it.
Well, there you go. It's out there.
That's what I say. It's out there. It's just not you and I. It's you and me. It's a lot of people, a lot of different places. Even President Obama. Google President Obama, and twice he's made speeches that we don't have time to argue with the Flat Earth Society.
I heard him saying that. Yeah, I saw that.
So you'll know, the Flat Earth Society is a setup of, to work against. So don't go to the Flat Earth Society. Look elsewhere for your information.
Right.
But even he's concerned that people are starting to wonder about the Flat Earth, The scientists are going, that's been dead for hundreds of years, that Flat Earth. You people are uncivilized, you're uncouth and you're unsmart.
Right.
You must be a Southern Christian.
Right.
To think that way. It's the only people that could possibly conceive that could be correct.
Right. I it just amazes me that people, let's just say that the flat earth was not true and the round earth was true. At the time when you talk about Copernicus and then, well, of course, later on Galileo and all those people started talking about the globe earth and Christopher Columbus and all this, and people were, mocking them, and they were saying, hey, these people are so dumb. And here it is, the same thing. People to have an idea, they were saying that the globe people were crazy. What's wrong with having a different opinion and be willing to research it and think about it? That's what I'm saying, instead of just blindly relying on what somebody told you. Unless you see it yourself, go to space yourself and see it, Well, you know, you don't know what you're seeing, if it's real or animation or what. And go by what you can observe. That's what we're talking about. There's lots of observable things that point to the earth being flat. That's the whole point, you know. Yeah, and we can't just throw those things away.
I'm just saying, you know, I don't know, but I'm just saying.
Right. Just like it that I mentioned Dr. Carl Ball, B-A-U-G-H, at the Creation in the 21st Century Museum in Glen Rose, Texas. He found, you know, dinosaur and human footprints in the same strata, you know, where there's supposed to be millions of years gap between the last dinosaur and humans walking the earth. He also found a hammer, the head of a hammer inside of some coal and stuff, you know, that's there. So there's a lot, what the government does, or the scientific, generally speaking, there are scientists who are Christians, but they just take anomalies and throw them out and say, oh, that's just an anomaly. Let's throw it out. They find the bones of giants. What they do, they hide them. They hide them and throw out the data and just run with data that matches what they want to, the story they're trying to promote. And that is not science. Just like with global warming. It's been proven. Someone had hacked, it was a couple years ago, you know, someone had hacked there, I think it's in Cambridge University or whatever it was in England, Oxford University, they had hacked their website and their emails, and they had been manipulating the data to support global warming. You know, and so that's what they do. They do the opposite of what legitimate science is supposed to be, where they would laugh and mock at us or people that don't agree with them, but yet they are the ones who have a preset determined outcome, and they try to skew all the data to get the answer they want to meet their agenda. And so they are very, most of the scientific community, as an example, look at this. If you were a scientist and you were, what these people do, archaeologists, scientists, and all that, they get grants from the government, they get grants through universities. And so if I'm a professor at, say, UCLA, and I say, hey, I want a grant to show that the earth is flat, you know, they're not going to give me the money. But if I say, hey, I want to make a research to show that the earth is a ball, or something on that topic that supports what their story is, of course they're going to fund that. You know, I want to disprove the, you know, make these flat earth ideas look bad. I want to make creation look bad. Of course they're going to get funding. So the government is even controlling, you know, what the scientists are studying, what they're calculating, what they're looking at. You know, they have peer reviews to pressure people not to come out. I mean, like Einstein. Everybody thinks Einstein was such a great revolutionary. What he did was he just thought outside the box, and the scientific community was bound up in their peer reviews, and anybody that tries to do something different, they beat you down, you know? That's not scientific, and it doesn't support advances in science. It supports, you know, don't make scientist so-and-so, doctor so-and-so look bad. Let's don't make this famous professor look bad. Let's don't make the government look bad. You know, let's just be politically correct and go along with promoting the stream of theory that they're following today. And while we're still going, Brother Sid, I'm still rambling here. It reminds me of the story of Lucy. There's a famous...
I just looked that up.
Well, see how it works? You know, that was proven later on to be, you know, this pygmy chimp. But
only about three of the bones were actually of the fossil, and they recreated all the other ones to make the feet and the hands to be humanoid.
Right.
And they passed that off as
and it was spread out over a mile or 3 miles or something like that. How are you going to find bones spread out by a mile and say they're from the same fossil anyway, you know? But you know what that guy did? This is what that scientist did. And I learned this from Dr. Carl Ball. And you can go look this up. What he did is he tried to carbon date those bones. And he said, you know, because they're always trying to find the missing link. If you find the missing link, you're going to get a bunch of money. You're going to get prestige. You're going to write a bunch of books. So you become famous. And that's what these people want to do. They want to be Indiana Jones. You know, they want to be famous. So they're motivated by self-gain and self-promotion to find something that nobody else has found. And so they even make stuff up. Like the movie From Here to Eternity, the Scopes Monkey Trial. It was proven later that tooth was from a pig, and they knew it was from a pig. And, you know, even when that movie was made, they already knew that that was not even a real missing link fossil, this pelt down man they talk about. It was really the tooth of a pig. But anyway, what that guy did with the while I'm talking about it, before I forget, with the Lucy, what he did is he sent pieces of that to like 10 different universities, because his theory was that it was the oldest known missing link, and it was, let's just say, I forgot now, he wanted to say it was 3 million years old or whatever. He sent it to different universities. He had a university like Oxford told him it's 20,000 years old. And then UCLA at Berkeley told him, oh, it's 10 million years old. And then another university told him it was 3 million years old. So every result he got was millions of years difference. And what he did, he took the study, the carbon dating that matched the closest to what he wanted it to be. He threw all the other studies away that were wildly different and published the one that matched his whole box he built, that this is the missing link. Now, this is how they operate in the scientific community. Intellectual dishonesty, as they say.
Yeah, excuse me, and that's why they always say, you know, theory of evolution.
Right.
Because it's just a theory, because they can't prove it. But as you say, they'll deceptively try to prove it any way possible. Let me ask you a question, and we can do a video about this. Have you ever seen a transitional fossil? You know, like a half fish and a half pig, or half pig and a half cat, or a half cat and a half, you know, orangutan, or a part of this and a part of that. You never seen a transitional fossil. There's no such thing.
Right.
And if you Google transitional fossil, you'll find that that's absolutely true. There are no transitional fossils. So if there are no transitional fossils through all these billions of years that we've supposedly been around.
Right. Billions. Yeah,
billions.
Right.
How can, I believe it's 4.5, something like that, billion years. So, and there's not one transitional fossil on record. They thought they found one, but later they found it was two separate fossils that just happened to be merged together.
Right, right.
So they've never found a transitional fossil yet. Evolution is true. It's just believed, because in the theory of evolution, that's what's taught in school, right? Globes taught in school. That's what's taught in school.
Right, right.
So it's true. It has to be true.
Right, and if
but
you look at it,
prove
yeah,
it. There's
right.
No, you know, observation versus science. Observation versus science. That's what we're looking at.
Right. I mean, it's just silly because, I mean, Hitler, you know, survival of the fittest. I mean, that's what Hitler did. He did survival of the fittest. I mean, that's, and if you would look also at Darwin, you know that Darwin was like a fourth generation inbred. His uncle actually wrote a book 50 years before that Darwin himself really, you know, kind of plagiarized his uncle, who was a professor, and you don't hear about that. And he just, you know, he was saying these blue bloods, it goes back to your Nephilim theory. These blue bloods, like these royals, they think if they inbreed each other, they're so perfect and so great and better than us regular people. If they keep inbreeding with each other, they'll produce the, you know, the next Christ, you know, the Messiah, the Superman, the Aryan race, you know. And so Darwin was actually like a fourth generation inbred, and these families kept inbreeding so much that they started becoming, you know, mentally ill and handicapped, that they stopped and they decided that their theory wasn't really working. But
he was a big Bible believer, and his daughter died, and he prayed to God, and she died anyway.
Right.
And he got all mad at God and went atheist on us, and then he went out and came up with all this, you know, the Galapagos Islands.
Right.
You know, that, and it's just because he was mad at God, and so we're basing our whole, you know, school system and everything else on a guy that was mad at God and a theory that cannot be proven.
Right, and that's the whole thing about it. They've run with it, and like you say, science, by definition, is the observation of nature. So none of us have been around to observe evolution, and they don't have any, they always talk about the missing link. They do not have, as you said, transitional fossils. There is no fossil record to support this theory. And as an example, I always think, when I remember when I was in school in 10th grade biology, they showed a giraffe, and they said the reason why a giraffe has a long neck is because they kept stretching their necks to eat the leaves out of the trees, and stretching their necks, and later on their neck stuck out. And they use that for all these different, this is where the information they use. It sounds insane.
Let me guess, there's no short neck giraffe fossils.
Right, right. And number two, you know, the Bible says that everything reproduces after its own kind. And like they talk about a tail. Monkeys became humans when they lost their tail because they weren't using it anymore. Now, the truth is if two people chop off their arms and then they have a baby together, the baby's going to have arms. My DNA, you know, and Darwin didn't know about DNA, but my DNA is not changed because I chopped off my arms. That's not going to make me produce a baby without arms. And so that's how silly is the ideas of evolution, this theory of evolution, because they you know, your DNA doesn't change from your hobbies and activities that you do.
Any observable change ever noticed has always been a loss in DNA, right. Has always been a loss, you know, in its characteristics. No, nothing has ever, in other words, nothing has ever higher, you know,
goes up, it goes down
to a higher level through evolution. There have been some losses in the chain,
right.
In time, but never an advance. Nothing has ever advanced.
Right. Well, you know, they talk about that, the second law of thermodynamics. That's a big one for your brothers and sisters. Entropy. In other words, if you take a piece of metal and lay it outside, a piece of iron or whatever, it's gonna turn to rust and turn back to dust. Even a person's body will too. It doesn't.
Anything immovable, you know, anything that stays the same, basically just, you know, falls to nothing.
Right. It's not gonna start growing and turn into a house.
Right.
So things break down to the least, you know, level, not build up. Yeah.
If you've ever seen any pictures of Chernobyl, where they, you know, evacuated the whole town, everybody that lived there, this huge place, you know, look at it now, you know, at the war, the everything is falling, starting to collapse, break down, you know, as you say, the second law of thermodynamics.
Right, everything goes to
nothing
the lowest.
Nothing new's grown because of all that radiation, nothing wild, nothing gone crazy, everything's breaking down, just like, you know, as it's supposed to.
That's right, that's what happens, that's what we see in observable nature. You know, we don't see things building up. As Sid was talking about, like that, this is what atheists will say. They'll say, we see the mutation of bacteria. But as Brother Sid said, and I heard a scientist give this explanation, and I talked to Sister E.A. Morn, who comments on videos a lot. She is actually a scientist, and she works with this actually with these kind of things, with medicines and stuff. And I asked her if this was true, and she said, yes, it was true. And I also talked to... there's a Sister Mary, she's in the medical field, she's a doctor, down in South Carolina. I asked her if it was true, and she also agreed that what I said was scientifically correct. That, in other words, you talk about immunity. Let's just say that we immunized everybody against measles. And then 1% of the measles, in other words, when you make a vaccine, as an example, it would attack the measles in a certain location, on a certain branch of the DNA or the molecules of measles and kill it. But some of the measles, say 1% of the measles virus, does not have that little branch. It's missing that branch of its formation of the molecules. And so it would survive and then it would begin to multiply and then measles would come back, as an example, or some kind of virus, the flu would come back. Not because it had adapted and overcame the virus, the immunization. It's because it was missing that piece. In other words,
it actually de-evolved.
Right. So if I put handcuffs on every man in the United States, but 1% of all men in the United States don't have hands. They've had their hand chopped off. And so if I put a handcuff on them, it would just slip right off. And they could escape. So, you know, those people would be free. So it's like missing a hand. Missing a piece of information, as Brother Sid said in the very beginning, that's the whole point. They're missing something that would have killed them or destroyed them.
It's a loss, not any gains.
Right. So that's where people that's the whole point too. People hear stuff that they heard in 10th grade biology, or they saw it on TV, or heard some atheist scientist like Carl Sagan say it, and they just keep repeating it enough. And then they just assume it's true without ever questioning it. Like we're talking about the spherical earth or evolution or any of these topics. People just accept it. And it's so funny that the atheists are the ones who say Christians, oh, you just accept what you've been taught. Well, there are lots of people who say they're Christians and they're not, and they just are following a tradition. But if someone is truly born again, brothers and sisters, I want to say that, to people that say that God doesn't speak and you can't hear from God and, you know, and all these kind of things, I always say, I pray and I ask you to question your own salvation if you don't think that God speaks to people. Because in order to get saved, it is an experience. And that's why I have a problem with people like this, like Erwin Lutzer, or what is his name, John MacArthur, these people that say, oh, we don't rely on experience, we rely on the Word of God. Reading some Bible verses didn't get me saved, brothers and sisters. It was when the Holy Spirit, as Jesus said, no man comes unto me lest the Father draws them. I got born again when the Spirit of God got a hold of my heart. I had an experience, a real, just like a scientific experiment. I observed, experienced, felt, and was part of an interchange between myself and the Creator of the universe. God, the Holy Spirit, talked to me in my inward being and confirmed in my heart, as Jesus said, He's the Spirit of truth. The Holy Spirit convicted my spirit man that Jesus is the Christ, that the gospel is true, that without Jesus I'm lost and without hope in this world, and that there is a hell and there is a heaven, and Jesus took my place, for the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. God convicted me in my heart supernaturally that's true. That's how I got saved. It was an experience that's tangible, a real manifestation of the Creator of the universe. That's salvation. Now that's real science. God is real. And if you didn't have any experience like that, I challenge you that, you know, you can't get saved without some kind of an experience. And that's what, as I say all the time, John Wesley, who was a mighty man of God, who founded a denomination that's not mighty anymore, the Methodist denomination, he called it mental assent. People that just say in their mind, okay, I believe the gospel's true. Yeah, I believe it. All up in their head. And there's tons of people who are watching this video right now. You got a head knowledge of God, and you believe in your mind that the gospel is true. But you got to believe with your heart and confess with your mouth. The Bible tells us, Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, you have to confess with your heart and believe, you know, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God raised him from the dead. This is an actual experience, something that's tangible and real, brothers and sisters, not in imagination. So when I sit here and say, oh, the earth is round because I saw a Photoshop photo from 1972 on the internet, that's something that's an image. That's not real. That's an image. Maybe it's real, maybe it's not. It's an image I saw on YouTube.
People, image could have been just shot out of a round window and you got a round picture.
Right.
And it's still flat.
Right.
It's still flat. It's not. You know,
right.
You don't see it. You don't see a ball. The only ball you see is an animation.
Right. It's that people put their faith and trust in all kinds of things, but the Lord, but the God who created them, and never
ceased. Jesus made it very clear, didn't he? You must be born of water and of spirit. A man must be born again.
Right.
And Nicodemus, he was trying to make that very clear. And your water birth is your natural birth.
Right.
And your spiritual birth is your birth into the kingdom. And if you haven't had that complete reversal of your life and experience. If you went to church one day, let's say you went to church and you do all these things and that's your life. You went to church and you got saved that day and you come home and the next week you did exactly the same thing that you did the week before. I challenge you to the fact that I'm not sure that you got born again that day.
Amen. Because it says, I always quote it all the time too, Romans 8, 14 and 16. It says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. And then the other one says, His Spirit will bear witness with our spirit that we are sons of God, children of God.
So, I'm like Brother Patrick, I know from my experience, you know, that whatever I used to do, what the man I was and the man I became are vastly different.
Amen.
And yet I believe just as much one side then as I do now in my mind. Like Brother Patrick said, in my mind, I believed everything was cool. Not so much. Everything was fixing to heat up for me when I had a heart attack in 2006. And we'll discuss that one day. But things were about to heat up, as they say.
The Lord lit a fire under you, huh?
Well, I think He taught me about where the fire was and where I was headed.
He let you look over the edge of the...
He let me look over the edge and see. And, you know, that's... It's a powerful story. And
Amen.
We'll do that one.
We'll have to do it. We've been going for a long time. I got to split this up.
Let's go. Yeah, let's end it.
Let's end it up. We're going to wrap with a prayer.
We'll think about something else. We'll come up with something else to talk about.
We'll keep on going all night. Yeah. Well, that's what's about. I had to get some coffee in a minute now if we're going to stay up all night. Well, let's close it out with a prayer, I guess. You want to do it?
I'm going to let you do it.
You're going to let me do it? Okay.
I'm going to let you do it.
Well, all righty, let's close it out with a prayer, brothers and sisters. And this video is probably going to be split in two or three different parts. And so, but we already made this actually one straight video. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we just want to thank you, Lord God, for YouTube. Thank you for the internet. We thank you for fellowship, for our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we ask you to bless everyone that would watch these videos, Lord. And Lord, I just pray that though, you know, that there's lots of brothers and sisters who love to get into debates and all that kind of stuff. And Lord, you know we're not on here to debate, but just to throw out and throw open the windows of heaven and the wisdom of God and just open up people's thinking to what's the truth, how to find truth in all things, and how to dig through all the lies and the layers of lies from our whole lifetime in this fallen world, Lord God. Father, we ask you just to bless everybody, that people would come on here to be under a spirit of peace and not of strife or debating or arguing. Because, Lord, you know we're not going to do it. We just want peace and joy to be upon everybody, Lord. And, Lord, we're just saying that we don't know the answers all the way on these secondary topics of creation about the earth being flat around. But, Lord, we want to know the truth, and we want people to be open not to believe what they've been told from the government, Lord, and from the fallen world. Father, we thank you right now for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the blood of Jesus. Lord, we pray that everyone that watches this will become born again, that their minds will be open to different and new possibilities, that God is real, that his creation is real, that evolution is not true, that the earth is not as the government says it is, but it is as the Bible says it is. And Father, we give you the praise and glory in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen, brothers
Amen.
And sisters.
Amen.
Amen.
While we have this tool, let's use it.
Amen. God bless, brothers and sisters. I'll be seeing you soon. By the grace of God, I'll be going to Philippines, you know, at the end of November. And then I'll be back. I shall return. See, I always say that because, you know, the Philippines, MacArthur is famous in the Philippines. I always use that expression, I shall return. When I leave the Philippines, I always tell them that. And they always laugh, no matter how many times I've done it. But I shall return to the States. I'll be in the southwest part of the United States, by the grace of God, at the end of April. I'll be out there on the west coast and southwest. And I hope to see all of you there. Please contact me from Las Vegas to Los Angeles to New Mexico, Arizona. Maybe it's up to the Lord. I'll be out in that area at the end of April, 1st of May time frame. Then I'll be back out here in Charlotte. We're going to have another conference, I think, sometime in May. And Brother Sid, I'm going to invite Brother Sid to come also. And he was busy and couldn't make it last time to our conference. And I pray he'll be able to come this time. And maybe he can, we can have some information about the topics we've been talking about tonight included in our deal there in Charlotte. So God bless all you brothers and sisters. And we'll see you again. And I hope that you exploit this enemy's holiday, exploit this pagan holiday, and bring glory to God in all ways on this Halloween time frame of the world. God bless.